I recently was asked to speak to a group of senior military officers, and I arrived at the rather grand venue and stood looking vaguely as if I hoped I was the speaker, and the senior military person present said, "Oh, good to meet you, Padre. When's the speaker coming?" And I could see his face fall when he discovered the speaker was me. At this lecture, we've had some of the most engaging speakers in contemporary English-speaking theology, such as Stanley Hauerwas, an absolute giant, and today you've got me. So I just hope I'm adequate to it. And what I want to tell you is a very simple story about the experience of people living in Sheffield, and how at the Cathedral we have tried to respond to that both theologically and practically. What we've done raises a number of quite deep ethical issues, and I hope that we'll be able to break a bit this evening and just consider how we respond. Has the Cathedral, have I, taken the right approach ethically? That's what I'm hoping we can discuss. And begin with this extraordinary picture by Giotto of the cleansing of the temple by Christ. It's extraordinary because it's, I think, the only picture where it looks as if Jesus is about to throw a right hook. Our Lord of the boxing ring. If you look very closely, there's a tiny little sort of cord in his hand that wouldn't really do anything to anybody, but it is. You can see this little child here is sheltering in his dad or granddad's cloak, slightly frightened of Jesus. Giotto didn't do this without knowing what he was doing. It's a very rare picture of Jesus about to threaten violence. And you can see at his feet there are the birds in a cage, there's an abacus on the table, and he's just thrown over the money changers table and some coins on the ground at his feet. Of course, this relates a story from all four Gospels at different times, which shows Jesus' passion for justice and for prayer. He sees the activities of these money changers in the temple as contravening contravening the law, so that people are having money skimmed off them as they change their Roman coins into the special temple coin so that they can pay temple dues without using a coin with a representation of Caesar. But it shows, I think, that right at the beginning of my faith tradition, there is a big question asked about finance and faith. And I've been spending, I think, the last 4 years trying to respond to the challenge of this text. It is written, "My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of thieves." The Cathedral constantly is facing a question of how far do we go? Where does the boundary come? For example, should we have a fashion show for people leaving Sheffield College for swimwear? Should we have a hip-hop evening led by a group of people who've been studying hip-hop in the city for a year? And is it appropriate to have hip-hop in the nave? Anyway, You'll have to work out for yourselves whether we said yes or no. Strangely, the word for table, trapezda, in Koine Greek is still the Greek word for bank. And it was after the banking crisis that we started to get interested in the question of justice and finance in our city. I've divided the talk into four, I hope, relatively brief sections. Firstly, I want to show you why I believe that there is a very significant financial problem in our region. Then explore the methodology that we've used at the Cathedral to take this forward, and a little bit about the ethics behind what we're trying to do. And then finally, I want to show you some of what we're actually doing at the moment. So I want to start with the background, and of course you may be familiar with the situation in Greece itself, which is perhaps one of the most badly affected of the European countries by the financial collapse. And there's very strong evidence now that the financial problems that we have seen over the last 6 or 7 years since the banking collapse, there's very strong evidence that they are getting markedly worse in South Yorkshire. And that's happening in three particular areas. Firstly, poverty, however we define it, is moving from being typical of people who have retired to being much more marked amongst people aged 18 to 30 or 35. Historically, the more elderly did considerably worse than everyone else. But actually, in real terms, they're doing better. Now, that doesn't mean there isn't very deep poverty, of course, amongst elderly people, but it's not as bad as it was. What's very striking is that people who were doing quite well in their 20s aren't anymore. There are 60,000 graduates in Sheffield who are not employed in graduate level jobs. And so not in a position usually to start seriously reducing their debt. That's very striking, isn't it? And there are also 60,000 people that we believe are in what we would call in-work poverty. People who nominally have work, but either the work is very poor quality, it's rather intermittent, it's paying less than the minimum wage, let alone the provision the government wants to bring in, quite rightly, the living wage, or conditions are so bad that people's health is badly affected. And these are figures that have just been released, by the way, so they're red hot. And many of the traditional supports that people had are no longer available. There are 15,000 people employed at Meadowhall, usually most of them in minimum wage jobs, and there are only 50 members of unions. The union movement, which would have provided historically such a strong, would have given people a sense of power and ownership and made them able to address questions of conditions or poor employment, just isn't engaging those who are in work poverty as we understand it. Families have broken down. So the large family structures that were typical of South Yorkshire are now chopped up into little bits. And finally, credit, as you may know, the government is introducing universal credit, a complete restructuring of the benefit system. And this is coming in South Yorkshire in 2018 in July, we believe. One of the things that Universal Credit does is that it tries to introduce the idea that not having work is the same as having, should be, feel like having work. So just as when you're paid monthly and you have to structure all your spending for that month and learn the skill of structuring your spending, so when you're not in work, your benefit will be paid monthly and you will have to learn how to structure your spending for a month. And all your benefit is paid directly to you, so housing benefit is no longer paid to the landlord, and you become liable for paying the landlord out of your own money, which feels very different for people who don't have those financial skills. Benefits are also in some areas reducing and in some areas not. But the basic model, which of course is Ian Duncan Smith's model, is that everyone is going to learn the same disciplines of work, and that will help people get into work more easily. It's actually a very imaginative idea, but it's a social experiment that is of such a size that nobody knows what's going to happen. And there's already a lot of evidence that in places where benefit is paid in this manner already, week one, people do very well. Week two, things are fine. Week three, the food bank queues start to get larger. And week four, people can't afford their heating. And that's simply because of that it's all very well saying you need to develop those skills, but with no support and already living in debt, perhaps it's tough. So there are a number of new and a few old financial institutions that are seeking to respond to this considerable indebtedness in our region. One of them may be very familiar, the Provident, which you may remember, in fact. The Provident lady, usually, will come round with a payment book every week and make you a loan and then collect a little bit every week. And if you can't afford it, she'll just add another week in. And, you know, the interest goes up a little bit, but that's fine. The Provident lady is paid every time the interest rises, according to some people. That's a slightly controversial comment because Provident deny it. But you can see here how much all this cost. The typical APR for a small loan is 1,557%. And although you can get as low as 535% APR plus fees if you start increasing your lending. Until last year, when new government regulation came in, they were showing a typical APR of 3,500%, which means that 1,500% doesn't sound quite as bad, you may feel. Wonga, who had those lovely knitted little old ladies and old men in their advert, similarly are offering a representative APR here of 1,500%. And that's typical because that's where the government, that's the highest current regulation permits. Sunny, you might be familiar with the wonderfully friendly, open adverts for Sunny if you watch daytime television. Not expect the clergy to answer that. Here, their representative APR here is 1,291%, maximum APR 1,617%, which is really digging it. We believe that there are about 50,000 households in Sheffield, that's 50,000 households in Sheffield, who have active loans from companies or similar companies like QuickQuid and Logbook Loans and so forth. And there's some variation between them. They're all offering loans of about 1,500% APR. And then quite aggressive charging, so that if you don't pay, there's a fee for a bounce check and then a fee for not paying. And they're more limited than they used to be, but it's still very bad. You also might know Bright House or Perfect Home. And you can actually track, using the map of Bright House and Perfect Home shops, the poorest communities in the United Kingdom. What Bright House offer, your weekly payment store, what Bright House and Perfect Home offer are a wide selection of white goods. And actually a very good quality of service initially. If you're going to buy this lovely washing machine here, usually their brands are sort of secondary brands like Beko and so on, but you know, it's they'll deliver in 7 days with your steam refresh cycle, and the APR doesn't look too bad at 69%. Or 70% actually, 69.9%. So the product price is given as £549.50, the total payable £1,092. But you'll find the, you'll find the same washing machine available in Currys for £350 at the moment, and in Boots Kitchen for just slightly under that. So what historically people have thought is that we need to educate people living in poverty, because who in their right minds would take out a deal like this? They see it's £7 a week. What they don't see is that it's £1,092 in total. But I can tell you that is wrong, because in addition, most of these companies require you to have the thing you're buying insured, so that and as very, very few people living in poverty can afford household contents insurance, there will be an additional insurance cost on top of that, which will in effect add another £100 or £200, depending on where you live. So the bizarre result of this is, it's cheaper to buy the most expensive washing machine sold by John Lewis than it is to buy really quite inexpensive machines at Bright House. But there's a reason that this is so appealing, because it's a way of sorting a problem. If your washing machine goes, in the past, you used to be able to go to a secondhand store and buy a washing machine that was well used but still working. That's much more difficult now because of new electricity regulations. And secondly, you used to be able to get grants from the council, which were quite generous 20 years ago, to help you buy a washing machine or a cooker, or even some basic furniture for your house. Those grants have almost disappeared, and they will disappear during the coming year. So the pawnbroker is another alternative way of getting money, and I've had some very interesting times visiting pawnbrokers in Sheffield. I followed on in a parish, a previous parish, I followed on somebody who had a clergy person who had pawned the brass eagle lectern in the parish when he was looking for a bit of money for a holiday, and then, unfortunately for him, not redeemed it. So the day after Easter Day, the archdeacon visited, and lo, it didn't go well. I mean, anyway, it didn't give a good message about the diocesan quota either. But seriously, then if you can't use Wonga or Bright House, if you've nothing to pawn, the moneylender is the next stage for you. This is a rather wonderful image showing a woman reading a prayer book, and next to her partner counting out money, and you can see a very anxious looking creditor in the mirror watching every penny as it goes. It's always said to be the moneylender and his wife, but of course that, I think, reflects art historical sexism. It could equally be the moneylender and her husband, because quite a lot of women used to work in moneylending. This is all very elegant, and a visit to the moneylender like this would be charming. It is not so in South Yorkshire. Although there is an illegal moneylending team in the police who are very effective, basically nobody knows how large the problem of moneylending is. If you work on some of our larger estates, you may have a much better understanding than the police. But the image of moneylenders coming, you know, as friendly is an error. Gentlemen usually with baseball bats and getting money with menaces back is unfortunately only too real. And what happens is they lend money to several people in your family or your circle of friends, and then if you don't pay, they'll threaten your son or your friend, and so you're under enormous social pressure to pay back. And it's often found that moneylenders operate in families, and indeed are prosecuted as families of four or five people, all of whom have been working together in different ways to threaten people. Now, so this is our time for a little relaxation. This is the Dean's happy dance, which is very rarely seen. Does the very quick story of debt ring true? People aren't quite certain, I think. We first did research on this for the Sheffield Fairness Commission, if you remember that, which was 5 years ago? 4 years ago? Five? About. And what that really showed was the level of debt was vastly more significant than anyone had understood, and very much more stressful for people. Anyway, back to work. And Church Action on Poverty, which is an excellent charity, and I commend it to you, it's a very good website. They sponsored some research in Barnsley on what it felt like, or what it feels like, to be living in poverty, in debt. And particularly, they were asking the question, do you know that some of the choices you are making are poor choices? Will education help you? Well, lo and behold, of course, every single person understood perfectly well that Bright House and Perfect Home and Wonga and Quick Quid and so on are poor choices. And a lot of local authorities invest very heavily in financial counselling, debt counselling for people, helping people put together product debt relief plans and negotiate with creditors. Excellent work, but actually, education isn't what people living in poverty need. They are just as intelligent as any of the rest of us. And one of the things that we've uncovered in our in this work is an extraordinary fear of senior officials when actually working in the area of poverty and exclusion. It's so stressful and so distressing that rather than talk directly to people in poverty, people operate with many unexamined assumptions about what people living in poverty need. And actually the whole national debate tends to operate at a slight remove from the lived experience of people in poverty. You see some newspapers blaming people living in poverty and trying to increase a sense of shame and exclusion. And you see other newspapers commenting with really no data at all on what the experience of poverty is like. That's why the Church Action on Poverty research is so very valuable. Because they developed a concept of a ladder. This is a wonderful image from St. Catherine's Monastery showing the ladder of salvation with little devils pulling people off it. Those of us who are paid monthly and are not in significant debt other than perhaps our mortgage can on the whole plan for several months ahead. We know we've got the summer holiday coming, we know the car will need to be serviced, and we can plan, better not spend too much this month because that's coming up, with whatever degree of sophistication we use, if necessary with jam jars at home. As you come down the ladder and have less money, your time frame becomes shorter and shorter and shorter. So people who are just about managing in work really are looking absolutely from paycheck to paycheck and making it last, and there's often a point at the end of the month where it's difficult. I stood in a newsagents in one of the poorer communities in our city and watched for an afternoon, on a Friday afternoon, how people bought heating credit and electric credit, and about 40 people came in and all of them put the minimum amount on the card, £5, because they knew that was all they had and that had to last them the weekend. That's a sign of, in a sense, they were planning for the next 2 or 3 days. When you start on benefit, gradually all your resources are used up. You sell things, you pawn them, you ask friends for money and help, and your sort of time frame gradually collapses. So you're looking for the next 2 or 3 days, how am I going to get through it? Making very difficult choices about electric rent, well, heating, rent, or food. And it's often as stark as that. I can get food for the children, but we're going to have to spend all day under the duvet. And so on. It's a very helpful, simple, because the aim of any intervention then should be to get people walking up the ladder and expanding the amount of time for which they can plan. But it showed us also something that's quite unexpected. If you are living in poverty, you need high quality, responsive service. Which it's obvious. Why would people living in poverty want any different quality of service from any of the rest of us. It's if your washing machine goes and you've five kids at home, you really need the wash, and there being very few laundrettes left, you really need a washing machine the next day. And the attraction of places like Bright House is because initially the service is fabulous. They come in and say, don't worry, we can get it to you 48 hours. You will take away your old machine, we'll install the new one, and we'll stay till we're certain it works. And then it's a problem solved for the next 3 or 4 days. And you know it's costing you a lot of money, but frankly, £7 a week in 3 or 4 years' time, you can just worry about then. You need immediate responsive service. And this has shown us that many of the interventions to assist people living in poverty aren't quick enough. People need very rapid response and good quality service so that things don't get much worse. This is, I think, a wonderful portrait of a woman living in really terrible poverty in the south of the States. We've also discovered that a key element of the experience of poverty in our culture is of shame. If you can imagine, as an adult, going to a food bank to feed your children, it's almost a public admission, I failed as an adult. Now, our food banks work incredibly hard to take away that sense of shame and to generate an understanding, we're working in this together, this is our problem, not your problem. But many interventions bring with them a certain amount of shame and fear. I've known people who have fallen into this sort of need, who felt unable to remain members of their faith community because they're so ashamed that they're so needy. So we studied this for 2 years and then have approached through a very controversial model. And it's this I'd like to explore with you. The harm reduction model you might be familiar with in substance abuse work. It begins with a sort of pragmatic understanding, much as we would like substance abuse just to end tomorrow, it's unlikely to happen. And by the way, government regulation has completely failed. So what are we going to do? Do we just tell everyone, no, 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 no? The harm reduction model suggests that it's much better to be pragmatic. It's going to take people time to get off drugs. Our experience in the Cathedral Archer project is that it takes 2 to 3 years to move someone from being on the streets, usually drinking, often with drug problems, and often psychiatric and finance problems, to a secure position. So what do you do during that time? Do you just say no? The harm reduction model, rather bizarrely, teaches people how to take drugs in a safe way. Acknowledging that it's not going to end instantly, people offer advice on how to inject, what to do if their arms no longer can receive any further injections, how to inject in your feet, and other places like that. Now, nobody wants that, but if people are going to do it, they need to do it in a way that is safe. And of course, you'll be familiar with needle exchanges and so on. The surprising thing about the harm reduction model is it's the most effective model, I believe, that we've found yet. because drug users feel trusted, feel that you're being absolutely honest with them, you develop a relationship which is a true relationship with your caseworker, and you enable them to stop damaging themselves more and then start to identify ways out of the problem. You can see how controversial this is if it's proposing, for example, that we set up in the centre of Sheffield an area for people, a building for people to shoot up in safely. I have to say I support it very strongly, but I can see the problem. But this model is saying, let's begin from where people are and lead them to a new place very gently, without judgment, is effective. And our question was, could we adapt this to finance? Sheffield DACT, D-A-C-T, as well as domestic abuse, also supports people with drug and alcohol problems, and uses this support very extensively. Now the question is the harm reduction model ethical? And in particular, can it be used by a church that we believe is called to the highest possible ethical standards? St. Paul puts it with typical incisiveness. Can we say, let us do evil that good may come of it? Of course, the answer to that is no. I was just talking with somebody before we started about the agonies that Lutheran Christians went through in Berlin under the Nazis. Was it legitimate to kill Hitler, an evil act, that good may come of it? Namely, no Hitler. That's a very, very extreme example. But prima facie, do you think that a harm reduction model can be used by a church? I'll explain a little bit more about what it means financially. Bad sign for me there. So, if we're not able to offer people who are in very difficult circumstances, we're not able to offer them loans at 24% APR, is it legitimate to offer loans at 90% or 100% APR as an alternative to loans at 1,500% APR? And this is what has riven, this debate has riven our approaches. I've taken one view and I'll tell you what it is, but can you see the difficulty? If we are saying that Wonga et al. Are essentially unjust, can we use some of their approach to service loans from people in very challenging circumstances as a way of weaning those people off debt and gradually teaching them better financial habits, ways of saving, and so on? There's very good evidence that it takes people need to go through two complete cycles of debt before they start getting enough control to be able to start saving. Do you think we are doing the right thing in offering loans? You can sign onto your mobile phone and get a loan today from an organisation which Sheffield Cathedral is a sponsor, offering 100% APR. If any of you are in employment, you'll get it much cheaper than that. But it's a really difficult area, and I'd have to say that in our work we have split the board of Sheffield Money in two more than once, because people feel so uneasy. Should we be lending to these people at all? I'm going to tell you my theological justification for it, and then I'd like you to vote on whether it's just deans being arrogant know-it-alls who throw the gospel out of the window at the first convenient moment, or whether you think we might be right.
Can I just ask a question first? Mm-hmm. Where does the interest go in that case? Is it recycled?
The interest, all our interest is recycled to similar people. It does change it a bit, but I'll explain to you this model. Thomas Aquinas is the go-to guy for the theology of debt to a certain extent. And he has an example of a bridge. We want to build a bridge over a dangerous river in which from time to time people are swept away as they try to cross the river. But we know that in building the bridge, it's very likely that one person or two people will die, because every time we built a bridge before, however good our health and safety, someone's ended up having a stone fall on them or whatever. And so it's likely that if we build the bridge, an innocent person will die. And we're very strongly committed to good health and safety, and obviously we don't want any innocent people to die. May we build the bridge? Now, none of us, fortunately, perhaps, are facing that decision immediately, though we do have a professional bridge designer on Sheffield Cathedral chapter. But in those circumstances, this isn't a trick question, would you build the bridge?
Yes.
Yes.
How many people would build the bridge? How many wouldn't? Cool, that's good for civic education. Well, St. Thomas Aquinas says you should build the bridge, probably. And he develops this idea called double effect. We're familiar with this already. If we were dying in the hospice, and there was a drug that would control our pain but shorten our life, most Christians would be very anxious to receive that drug, because its primary effect was to reduce our pain. Even if we knew that if we take that drug for a month, it'll kill us anyway. We're probably not going to live that long, so we'll take the drug that's dangerous.
You're going to put that to the vote as well?
I will in a second, when I've done the... So St. Thomas Aquinas says it's possible to take a drug that will significantly reduce our suffering, even if it has a possible bad effect that's secondary, like in the end reducing our life. I mean, this is a decision that doctors and patients with their doctors are taking all the time. And Thomas Aquinas set some five conditions. Firstly, what we're doing has to be worthwhile. You know, you can't use this if you're just wanting to see if the drug's nice. If we really mean to do something good, in the case of the bridge, to prevent further deaths from people being swept away, we're allowed to do it if the bad effect is not intended. And so he would say you couldn't shoot Hitler, because that's the main thing you're doing. And again, the bad effect isn't the way to produce the good effect. You're not allowed to, again, according to Aquinas, shoot a tyrant. And then finally, what you're trying to achieve is much more significant than the bad effect. And you can't separate them out. So it has to really matter. For example, it wouldn't be enough if you had a bar of chocolate while you were ill that would be lovely, but would reduce your life expectancy by a week for every square you ate. You couldn't apply double effect, even if you like chocolate quite enough, because the good is trivial. So that's either what, if you agree, that's what you call a thoughtful ethical argument rooted in the Christian tradition. And if you don't agree, you say it's unscriptural casuistry that's typical of deans. So this is the rationale for using the approach I'm going to explain to you that we have taken to reducing poverty in Sheffield as one amongst many different approaches. Let's have another vote. Pardon?
How do you relate that to ends and means in the philosophical argument?
Well, you could describe this in terms of ends and means, and in effect saying that an evil consequence is acceptable for a truly something that might come out of seeking a truly good end. But you could not use an evil means to reach that end. I'm reading a book on logic at the moment, so I might need to be remarked on that later. So if you want you to vote now, having seen my if you're inclined to get migraines, just stepping through those five things might actually bring you to migraine. I just have a little hobby horse now. I'm astonished by how little the Church of England and the churches more generally teach ethics. We do an enormous amount on mission, quite properly, we do lots on the scriptures, but I find that very frequently when people come to talk to me, they want to talk to me about questions of business ethics, of, you know, what is the right thing in this situation, what do I need to bear in mind if I'm feeling that perhaps I need to end the relationship with my partner. It's very complex ethical decisions that people want support with, and I don't think that we are exploring those fully enough, as if we knew the answer to everything. We don't. So, having seen that argument, do you agree with St. Thomas Aquinas?
Should I ask a question?
Mm-hmm, of course.
Who picked the idea of the 100% interest?
I'll explain that in a minute when I come to look at it, if I may. But that's in essence and partially arbitrary, and partially based on an understanding of risk, and partially based on who we can lend to, because no one can lend to someone who can never pay it back. But that's where it comes out about. So.
When it comes to in relation to this question, are we distinguishing between what the church should do and what the state should do?
At the moment, we're talking about what the church should do. Sheffield Money is based on a model that says we're going to get, that it's very likely over the next 20 years, state intervention is going to reduce, and the amount of money available for the third sector, for the faith sector, and for general public investment in people living in poverty is going to reduce. That might be quite wrong, and that's a different debate. But if that is the case, we need to find solutions that do not require long-term funding from the state. And that's exactly, no, if we had a left-wing socialist government, this might look very different, but in fact we don't. So how do we engage with that? And an interesting question would be, which of us would predict that we will? When the socialist revolution comes, it's not going to be good for deans, you know. So which of you, having seen that rather challenging argument, do you think you are more likely to support a harm reduction approach or less likely? Are you more likely? Oh dear. Are you less likely? Yes, so definitely. And this is the sort of debate we've had. This is Sheffield money, of which the cathedral is was instrumental in setting up, and I'm the chair. Slightly to my irritation, we don't appear in the logo, but there we are. What we've negotiated with the city is that we will offer loans to people who have no access to fair loans, and indeed to everyone else, but our primary focus is on people who've no access to fair loans, who would be charged interest at 1,000% APR plus. And we've negotiated with fair financial providers products that allow us to fund people in fairly difficult circumstances with loans that we believe are a fair rate of interest for the risk they offer. And this is where, after much discussion, we've come to a decision that 100% APR is the maximum we would be willing to go in most circumstances. And that decision was taken through discussion with the unions, with people in poverty talking about their own experience, what they need, with advice from risk experts, and looking at what products we could negotiate. But this is continually difficult. Is it an ethical thing to do to lend to someone in those circumstances? And then there's the second, yes.
Is there a development of credit unions in Sheffield?
There's an excellent credit union in Sheffield. There are several. Sheffield Credit Union is going to be speaking tomorrow, or you're going to be hearing some of their work tomorrow. Credit unions can now charge up to 49.5% APR, and they always encourage saving, especially at quite small levels. But credit unions historically have not lent to this demographic that we're seeking to loan to because they're too risky. And credit unions on the whole, this is not true of all credit unions, are very slow, as you may feel this talk is, but very slow in responding. So typically it takes 2 or 3 days, whereas we've discovered you need to respond immediately. That's not true of Sheffield Credit Union, which is much quicker than that usually. But the government had hoped that credit unions would come in and engage this segment. But because credit unions are owned directly by their savers, they are reasonably risk averse, and very few credit unions will work with the sort of the group we're working with. And sort of typically we're making loans of say £100. Someone is starting work in a month's time, needs to buy a uniform or steel cap shoes and so on in order to start work, but has absolutely no funds to do that, and has no funds to afford a weekly or monthly bus pass. But by lending the money, we're able to make that all possible, and then agree a loan period of say 3 months that will allow it to be paid out of the income that the person's getting. It's quite small things like that. But people do come in. The very first loan request we had was from someone coming in wanting to pay for a paternity test before court on the coming Monday. Pure Jeremy Kyle. Now, some colleagues said, quite wrong to lend to that person, because that's a frivolous use of the money. I think that's a rather judgmental approach to it. But we lend to anyone who meets our criteria, who isn't borrowing money for something that is obviously frivolous. We will not lend for people who are about to put the money on the horses, and that's about all. And you see, because if they don't come to us, they're very likely to go to somebody else and then pay a lot more and start in this cycle of getting into quicker and deeper debt. We believe our products will help them get out of it. We've discovered that we can only work online, and we've also discovered that almost all the people we want to lend to have smartphones, and so that's the best way to reach them. That was something we thought face-to-face would be important, and after 6 months of offering face-to-face work, we discovered we had almost no loans coming through that. Everything was happening online, and so it's basically the only way we continue the model. And this is a sort of typical loan here. Satsuma, who advertise on television, very much like Sunny, to borrow £300, you would repay £574.60 at 1,575% APR. These APRs are available very recently, about a week ago. Cash converters, again, you're paying £214, 628.7% APR. With Sheffield Money, that's 338. That's nearly 60% APR. Now, you may feel that that is unacceptable, and I certainly, there are very few of us who are in work that I'd recommend that sort of loan to. But if you're looking for a rapid purchase of a cooker that's just adequate, you see how different that is. Our APRs are almost all under 100%, but we have permission to go up to 213%. And again, that's very challenging with the board. That's offered a product offered called Uberima. And we think actually we're going to withdraw that product. All of our products are commissioned from ethical companies that are owned by, almost all of them are from community benefit companies, social enterprise as we are. And almost all of them, the money goes directly back into products for the saver. The one that won't is the next one. We will be starting soon to do white goods with a loan, but we can already beat almost every in-store finance deal in the city. I say almost every because there are one or two that are just slightly better, but our clients wouldn't be accepted. Because we've seen it's so important to run the quality of service, we're working with a company that will allow us to deliver in 24 hours all the products we offer on our website and install and maintain. Then what's different too is our consumers will own the product from the moment it arrives, rather than Bright Ice and so on, where usually they don't. Now, if I'd thought as a result of my theological education that I'd be comparing washer dryers, you wouldn't have thought of it. But this is really quite new. And as you see here, we're working with large employers in the city to offer savings accounts and other similar products. Now, I'm just about to come to an end here, so one of the ethical issues we've had is the harm reduction model in fact ethical? Is it ethical to charge so much money as a way of leading people away from truly destructive products? Then the second issue we've had is it right to lend people for things that we don't approve of? Like, is it right to lend £1,000 to someone who is really in pretty difficult financial situation in order to buy an up-to-date 3D television? I argue it is, if they're going to go elsewhere. Other colleagues argue it isn't. And then finally, is it right that a community benefit company, which makes will never make any money, is intervening, providing alternatives in the market to well-established companies that are making a lot of money, because we don't pay tax. People aren't thrilled.
I mean, there are moneylenders out there, and you'll be undercutting.
Yes, we will. Yes, and I mean, moneylenders, I suspect, aren't paying tax either. But the difficulty we've had is with some directors who come from a very particular position politically feel that a charitable organisation ought not to be providing a discount because it doesn't need to make a profit and it doesn't need to pay tax. And that's a further issue, that if we ever became significant, which I think is pleasant to think about, but not going to be.
But the ethical position of most of the competitors is worse.
Oh, it's much, I'd say, of course, there are some highly ethical people working in this area, but there are many that are not. And I think that, I don't see how people can sleep at night when their company is charging people 1,500% interest. As you see, this is Lincolnshire, and at least has the cathedral in it. We're going to be opening next month in Lincoln. As Lincoln money, we'll then be operating in Hull, as Hull money perhaps. Then there are South Yorkshire money and so on, which are effectively the same website but with different names, and working with local people to work out what the right product is for that community. Now, this is the other challenge. This model can only work with very high volumes, because we need about 20,000 loans per year in order to sustain it in the long term. Or, you know, if you add in white goods and so on, a bit less, but it's still quite a large volume of people to work with, because we make we've negotiated with all our providers a tiny part of the profit they make to support us bringing in the customer. And so we need, no customer will pay more through going through us. So we need a very large volume of people in order to cover our costs. And that's also an issue. So I hope, there we are, we're finished. I hope you find that interesting as an example of how engagement in work that's to do with justice has required us to explore some very unfamiliar areas of theology in order to discern, is this right? And I hope you find it interesting. And the particular thing I'd like you to reflect on is, what is it like to live in poverty in the communities I live in and serve? The scriptures have an enormously rich teaching about the poor, the powerless, and those in poverty. But we often fail to make the connection with the lived experience of those around us. And in a sense, I think that's one of the challenges that we believe we are being asked to do in the cathedral. So, thank you.